Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to our worship service this morning. And we give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Clark County area or looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John your new church home. This not being a communion Sunday, all of the service will be in your hymnal this morning, except for the one hymn which is on the back of your bulletin. Everything else will be in the red worship book. So I ask that you turn to page 94 to the order of confession and forgiveness, and I'd invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess
that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We now begin our worship with hymn number 742 in the back of your worship book, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Hymn number 742.
This hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus, was written in 1860 by a minister who came from Dublin, Ireland to Canada. He was Plymouth Brethren. He had suffered through the loss of two fiancés. One died of drowning, one of tuberculosis. He devoted himself to God, and this is what a friend. Jesus was his friend. What a friend we have in Jesus. Joseph Scriven, Plymouth Brethren, Canadian minister.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Do the first reading.
The first reading is from Acts. Now the apostles and the believers who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also accepted the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him, saying, "Why did you go to uncircumcised men and meet with them?" Then Peter began to explain it to them, step by step, saying, "I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision. There was something like a large sheet coming down from heaven, being lowered by its four corners, and it came close to me. As I looked at it closely, I saw four-footed animals, beasts of prey, reptiles, and birds of the air. I also heard a voice saying to me, 'Get up, Peter, kill and eat.' But I replied, 'By no means, Lord, for nothing profane or unclean has ever entered my mouth.' But a second time, the voice answered from heaven, 'What God has made clean, you must not call profane.' This happened three times. Then everything was pulled up again to heaven. At that very moment, three men sent to me from Caesarea arrived at the house where we were. The Spirit told me to go with them and not to make a distinction between them and us. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. He told us how he had seen the angel standing in his house and saying, 'Send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will give you a message by which you and your entire household will be saved.' And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon him, just as it had on us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said, 'John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' If then God gave them the same gift that he gave us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could hinder God?" When they heard this, they were silenced, and they praised God, saying, "Then God has given even to the Gentiles repentance that leads to life." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Becky Dimitrov will do the Psalms.
Yeah.
word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We're singing the gospel acclamation. Our pastor is Pastor John Pollock, who will now be reading the scripture. Our theme today is the love of God, and the Gentiles are a part of that. Learning that from the scripture, pastor's reading the scripture, Pastor John Pollock, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Fifth Sunday of the resurrection, the fifth Sunday after the resurrection.
Praise band will perform.
Oh,
sermon notes as we prepare to study God's Word, the 13th chapter of the Gospel according to St. John, and we are focusing on verses 34 and 35. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Back in the 80s, in order to try to increase flying tourism, the Commonwealth of Virginia came up with a slogan, "Virginia is for lovers." And it's kind of caught on across the nation, and you can go to other states and you see t-shirts with "Kentucky is for lovers," or "Tennessee is for lovers," or "Indiana is for lovers." But Virginia was the original one. At the time, I had an older sister and her family lived in Charlottesville, Virginia, and we would go visit in the summer. And I can't say that I ever saw an increase in tourism each summer when we were there. But they lived in Charlottesville, which is not exactly a tourist hotspot, so maybe it had an effect. I don't know, but one thing I can do, and this is for sure, and that is the church is for lovers. And when the world sees the church practicing this love towards one another, they are drawn to the church. In our gospel lesson for today, again, we are in the upper room the night of Jesus' betrayal. He has washed the disciples' feet. He has instituted the Lord's Supper. Judas has left to betray him. That is why the gospel lesson today began by saying, when he had gone out, speaking of Judas, he's going out to arrange his dirty deed. So with Jesus, knowing what lies before him, knowing that Judas is going out to betray him, knowing that when they go to the Garden of Gethsemane, he will be handed over to evil men, that he will suffer and die. Even with all this on his mind, his words of concern are about his disciples and about us, his modern day disciples. His concern is for us and for our comfort, our faith, and our strength. And so as he speaks to them, he tells them, telling us as well, that a new commandment I give you, that you love one another just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. But the question today is, how accurate of a description of the church is this in the modern world? How accurate of a description is this for the local congregation, for the synod, for the national church, and for the international church? When visitors come to a church today, do they feel that love among members, or instead do they feel the tension within the church they are visiting? Do they feel a sense of schism, a sense of anger, a sense that this congregation is sitting on a powder keg and ready to go off? Do the members of congregations today really love each other as Jesus means when he gives us this new commandment? Is the congregation a congregation that is there with compassion? Or is it a congregation of judgment? As most of you know, I grew up in Kentucky, and having grown up in Kentucky, the buckle of the Bible Belt, radio and TV were dominated by those churches that did an awful lot of judgment. That each Sunday all you would hear about was hell, and who was going to hell, and who, even Christians, going to hell because they were not of this denomination or that denomination. And then when we had all the civil unrest, and we had the hippies, and we had the anti-war demonstrators and so forth, then you would hear these preachers rail on about how all those people were going to hell. So is the congregation compassionate? Reaching out to the sinner, realizing that we all sin and fall short of the glory of God? Or are we judgmental, thinking we are like the Pharisees, that somehow we are more righteous than this sinner because our sins aren't as obvious or public as the How do you justify that with Jesus' command to love one another as he has loved us? As Jesus gives his command, he is not talking about the Christian's love for the world. He has already done that through his public ministry with parables such as the Good Samaritan, showing us that we are to love all of God's people and that everyone is our neighbor, not just those who are like us, not just those who are from the same ethnic background or same nation or same language or have the same education or the same socioeconomic group, but that everyone. But now this commandment he's directing to those of us who are his followers, those of us who make up the church of which he is the head. And to us he is saying that we are to love one another as he loved us. So the church is for lovers. The church is for lovers, first of all, because we are given the command to love. And when we fulfill that command to love, we are being obedient to our Lord Jesus Christ. A new commandment, he says. A new commandment I give you. That word new means to be fresh. It means to be distinctive. In other words, this isn't just another oral law being thrown on the pile of the other oral laws that were fenced around the original Ten Commandments. Jesus has taken us beyond the oral law. He's taken us beyond Moses and the Ten Commandments. This is a new, fresh, distinctive edict that we are to follow. The word commandment means a charge. It means a decree, an edict. And how it is used in our verse, in our text, it also stresses the authority of the one giving the edict over those who are to receive it. So it is saying, without reservation, that Jesus is our authority. And that everything we do, everything we believe, everything we confess is based on what Jesus said, not what we think. And he is saying that the church is made up of what he has commanded, not what our political agenda might be, or our social agenda, or our educational agenda, or our scientific agenda, or our sports agenda, or all those same tips in America seem to influence our Christian faith and seem to oftentimes put us at odds when we really examine it with our Lord Jesus Christ. So by saying a new commandment, he is saying, by my authority over you as head of the church, this is what you are to do. The word give means to bestow something upon someone or to commit it to them, for them to hold on to, for them to keep, for them to guard, for them to pass on to and share with others. So this new authority over us, this new command he has given us, is something he is entrusting to us, so that we can carry on his earthly ministry. So that we can continue to bring people into the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ. That we can continue to reach out to those in desperate need of the good news of the gospel. So the church is for lovers because we have been given a command to love. The church is for lovers because we have a people to love. And that, of course, is one another. Jesus has said, love one another. Here the word love has several meanings, all of which are important. The word love here means, first of all, to sacrifice for others. This is what our Lord Jesus Christ did for us. He sacrificed himself so that we might have salvation simply by believing in his redeeming and atoning death on the cross. Believing that on that third day he rose, and believing that 40 days later he ascended into heaven where he waits to come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. So as he sacrificed for us, we are to sacrifice for others. Jesus faced that horrible death so that we might live, so that we might be his own and live under him and his kingdom. And when we think about that, how embarrassing it is when we look over the history of the church in America and see how many congregations have had division and dissension and gossip and even split apart over the most ridiculous and silly things, especially compared to the sacrifice Jesus Christ made for us. The word also means to give your all. Jesus gave his all for us. He gave every bit of himself as a payment for the sins that we commit, so that we might be children of our Heavenly Father. He held nothing back. And he is saying that as his followers, we are to give our all to him and to give our all to each other. Now, if we're honest and look at ourselves in the mirror, how many of us can really say that we give our all to Jesus each and every day? How many of us can really say we give our all to our brothers and sisters in Christ each and every day? Too often, the hustle and bustle of life causes us to sometimes forget about Jesus until the last moments of the day before we go to bed. But Jesus is saying we are to give him and to give each other our all for the good of the church and the good of his kingdom. The word love here means to conquer the will to seek the highest good. And this is something that has been a major problem in the church in America. People refusing to conquer their selfishness for the good of the congregation. Seems like so often congregations have a few people that come into power and have an influence over a congregation, and everything must be done their way or no way. Two examples that I'm familiar with. When I served one congregation in Kentucky, it was founded on Epiphany, January 6, 1806, by five German families who came from Virginia. When I arrived in 1981, there were still direct descendants of those five families. One of those descendants was a strong-willed woman who believed that it was her way or the highway. She believed that because of her heritage, she had the right to dictate what the church should or shouldn't do. She got angry with me because one Bible school, it was one of those years when Easter was as late as it could be, so Pentecost was as late as it could be in June. We were having Bible school, so I had the children and all the grades make a banner for Pentecost. And this church along the outside walls had lights all the way down. And so I had the children hang these banners over those lights. Well, that Sunday morning after church, she just yelled at me and scolded me and you know what to me because of the rags, dirty rags hanging on the lights. Instead of saying how wonderful the children took the time to make these banners, she thought it was insulting to her ancestors' church. Then a good friend of mine who was a pastor out west, or in the far Midwest, was a pastor of a large congregation where there was a couple who were the richest in the congregation. They were the biggest farmers in the county. They had the most land, made the most money. And because everyone just assumed they were the biggest givers in the congregation, if a pastor proposed something and they didn't like it, it didn't pass. Well, my friend brought to the council, the congregation, how the church had reached the point where they needed to build a new building for some of their ministers. Well, this couple opposed it. Once they made it known that they were not for it, everybody began to back off their support. Well, my friend did something that I don't think I would ever do, but he had the nerve to do it. He went to his treasurer. And he said, let me see the giving record to this family. An amazing thing was discovered. That this richest family in the congregation, that everybody thought was giving so much money, had not given a dime to that congregation in any form of offering, fund drive, or anything else ever since they had been there. And this was like 35 years yet they had a stranglehold on that congregation that most people just assumed. When my friend made it known to the council, the building passed, the couple left, and the church grew by another 1,000 people. So when Jesus says we have to love one another, he is saying we have to suppress our will, our desires, what we think, when it conflicts with the good of the congregation. Now that's not saying you can't ever disagree with something that's proposed, but it's saying that make sure you have a legitimate disagreement and not simply because it goes against your selfish desires or wishes. The last meaning of the word love here is the ability to love the unloved. No one gets friends with everyone in a congregation. It just rarely works that way. But through the power of the Holy Spirit, we can love that brother and sister in Christ as a fellow member and treat them as Jesus wants us to treat them. Doesn't mean we have to have them over every weekend for supper. Doesn't mean we have to go to the movies with them. But it means we do treat them with the respect of being a fellow brother and sister in Christ Jesus. So the church is for lovers, in that it has a people to love each other. Third, the church is for lovers because of the nature of that love, Jesus Christ, the King of the church, the Lord of the church, the groom of the church, whatever imagery you want to use. Jesus is our example, and his example is that of love. So because he is love, his church is for love. Now we are to have that same kind of love as Jesus had. A new commandment I give you, that you love one another just as I have loved you, so you also are to love one another. So just as I have loved you. Here the word love means to give what is needed. Jesus gave us what we needed. Salvation. Jesus gave us what we needed. An open door to a relationship with God the Father, our Creator. Jesus gave us what we needed. Forgiveness of sin. And where there is forgiveness of sin, there is salvation. Where there is salvation, there is eternal life. So Jesus gave us what we needed, eternal life. Jesus reversed the tragedy of the garden, whereby the first Adam's actions, we were separated from God. Now by the actions of the new Adam, we are restored in a relationship. So the church is for lovers because of the nature of the one who found it, our Lord Jesus Christ. And third, the church is for lovers because of the evidence of that love. Verse 35, pay special attention to what Jesus is saying. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. By this, all people will know that you're my disciples. By what? Our love for one another. Not by how magnificent our building is. Not by the fact that we have or don't have a Starbucks or Dunkin' Donuts or some other franchise in our lobby when you come in, and a gift store next to it so people can come in throughout the week and have a cup of coffee and go to the bookstore and buy inspiration books and see the DVDs of the church service a week before and so forth. That's not how we'll be known. It's not that we'll be known by all the athletic teams we sponsor. We won't be known by the gym we have that we let people use for all kinds of things. We won't be known by our location or our heritage or the ethnic group that founded our congregation. We'll be known by our love for one another. By this, all people will know that you're my disciples if you have love for one another. The word know means to perceive something or to distinguish. So Jesus is saying the world will distinguish you are my followers instead of the followers of some world religion by that love you show for each other. They will perceive you are my followers by that love you show for each other. The word disciples means, of course, a follower of a teacher or one who imitates a teacher. Here it also means the rule of conduct to be followed. So Jesus is saying the rule of conduct And then again, here the word love means to give what is needed. That we give what is needed to each other. Maybe it's just to say hello. Maybe it's just to drop somebody a card who has suddenly become shut. Maybe it is to make a telephone. Maybe it is to offer to pick up someone who cannot drive anymore and bring them to worship. Or to pick up somebody for an evening service who doesn't drive or doesn't feel comfortable driving anymore at night time. These are all the little type things we can do to show the world that we love one another. One person told me how when their mother was in the hospital, down south, that every day she was in the hospital, a member of the congregation visited. Even if the member, she didn't know the member knew who, her, they went just to drop by, to support her, and give her some encouragement. I can remember a Baptist pastor that I was friends with told me how Monday was the day he went to the hospital. And that was the only day he went unless there was an emergency. But the other days, his members knew they were good. And they were to see that person, to show that love, that doing what is needed for one another. A lot of them have churches today. One of the activities they do are small groups. These small groups function as a way of keeping tabs on each other, helping each other, supporting each other. It's also a way of inviting new people into your congregation. That's how our middle son started going to the church he goes to. A friend of his belonged to a small group of this church, and he invited him to come to the small group. They were going to have a cookout, and they were going to discuss some topic. And so it interested our son, and he went. And afterwards, and they invited him to come to church on Sunday. And when he got there at church, they met him. Some from the small group made sure they sat with him, introduced him to other people. And now he's doing the same thing, having joined that congregation. And so often seems that so many of these mega churches, that is what they have, these small groups. Because then people feel that love from others that Jesus is saying we're to have for each other. So the church is for lovers. It is for lovers because we have been commanded to love by our Lord Jesus Christ. It is for lovers because we have a people to love each other. It is for lovers because of the nature of that love, which is to follow the example of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it is for lovers because we show that evidence of that love to the world. Having that kindness and support for each other. So I don't know how successful the Commonwealth of Virginia was with their little campaign of Virginians for lovers. My sister and her family moved out. I don't know if that had anything to do with it. But the church is definitely for lovers. And when the church shows that love, the world is drawn to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We will now sing A New Name in Glory, which is printed on the back cover of your bulletin. A New Name in Glory, printed on the back cover of your bulletin. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of life, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Service, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is April the 24th, 2016. You're listening to the Praise Band, fifth Sunday of Easter. We invite you to come to our service, 10:30 service. You're watching it now on YouTube.
praise you this day for your Son, Jesus. We thank you for his ministry and his teachings, that we might better understand your will for our lives. Help us, O God, to praise you for Jesus and for all your blessings. Fill our hearts to overflowing, that like the psalmist, we may praise you and adore you with our lives, with our hearts and minds and spirits. May our praise of you lead those around us to want to know you and your blessings. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father God, we pray for the leaders of the nations of the world. Bless them and their people to work for peace among the nations. We pray especially for the peace of Israel, and ask the Lord that you would bring that nation and her citizens to know you and Jesus Christ, your Son, to be the true Messiah. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Gracious Father, we lift up to you all in need of your healing touch. Grant healing of body for the sick, comfort of the soul for the grieving. Bring peace of mind to those whose minds race with worry or confusion. Bless them all to know that peace which passes all understanding as they put their trust and hope in you. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father God, watch over those who serve in the military at home or overseas, who serve here as police, firefighters, or EMTs. Assure them of your love. Give them the mind of Christ to carry out their duties humbly, faithfully, and with a servant's heart. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Holy Father, we thank you that you are always watching over us and taking care of us, that you know our needs and are gracious to supply them. Supply the needs of those who are poor and hungry, the unemployed, the underemployed, refugees, aliens, victims of violence and abuse, those whose land is torn by war or natural disaster. Use us, O Lord, as your means to supply their needs. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father God, you promise us in your word that one day you will wipe away every tear from our eyes, and there will be no more death or grief or crying or pain. Assure those who grieve the death of loved ones of this promise, and sustain them in their grief with the hope of eternal life. Give them faith to entrust their dearly departed loved ones into your care, and to look forward to the day when they shall join them and all the saints around your throne of glory. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We conclude our worship with Shine, Jesus, Shine, hymn number 671. A few directions. We begin with the refrain, then we all sing verse 1 in the refrain. Then the band will sing a verse that is not printed in your book. Then we will join them for the refrain, then all sing the last verse printed in the hymnal, and then the refrain. So we sing refrain, verse, refrain. Don't sing while the band sings verse, then refrain, verse, refrain.
This is a modern hymn written by Graham Kendrick, 1987. He was born in 1950. Hymn from the Western Hemisphere, Shine, Jesus, Shine, 1950, 1987, contemporary hymn.
Jesus, shine, fill this land.
watching our service on YouTube. This is April 24th, 2016. We have the praise band performing for us. We're happy to bring you this service. Our church office, Christian School. We have 8 o'clock service. We have a 6:30 service in the chapel where you can receive Holy Communion. This is the fifth Sunday of Easter. You can see Jesus' resurrected body. You will put your faith in Jesus. He will save you. This is the praise band singing, "Shine, Jesus, Shine." Joining us in our worship this Lord's Day. I hope and I pray that God will continue to bless you and keep you this day and all your days. We will pray for you. Continue to pray for us. Note that the flowers today are in honor of Linda Fox's birthday and Debbie Cochran's birthday. Mike Cochran gave the flowers. We have the flowers on our altar, always fresh, beautiful, and in honor of these two birthdays, Linda Fox, the president of our church council, our videographer, and also Debbie Cochran, very active in the church, and their flowers are presented in their honor today. Thank you for worshiping with us. We'd love to see you come in person if you're watching this video. 10:30 service, 8 o'clock service on Sundays, 6:30 in our chapel for communion.